Hey guys, we're here with some of our amazing team in New York, and we're going to be talking about dinner party leadership. We're so excited. It's been such a part of our journey here in New York. We started our first dinner party, or you might call it a connect group or just a group, but we started our dinner party really a week after we arrived in New York, right,
babe? Yeah, it was quite quick.
It was really quick because people were texting us and asking, hey, what's happening? You've landed. And we were kind of like, we're just jet lagged. But we were able to jump straight into kind of gathering people. I won't say into our apartment because it definitely wasn't. We didn't have an apartment
yet. Yes. Just found a random person. Actually, it was my sister.
Right. And so we were just able to gather people. And I think it was about five people that first night. And we kind of said, just come over. Josh spoke a word. What did you speak on?
I spoke on Paul's words to Timothy. Yes. God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. I was just preaching to myself, of course.
And me.
Yeah.
And so it was just the start of something that we didn't really even know had birthed that night, because from that Wednesday onwards, we've never not run a dinner party in our church.
Wow. Yeah.
And so a few months later, we multiplied from 1 into 10 in one night.
Yeah.
And from then, it's just been multiplying. And now we see dinner parties all across the city every Wednesday, all across our church in all different types of spaces. So it's just been such a powerful way to build the church.
Yeah. And early on, we didn't realize that this would become such a backbone of our church. But as we studied Acts 2, 42 to 47, we realized that the first thing that happened out of Peter's message and thousands of people receiving Christ is that God gave the church a blueprint of how to care for people, how to disciple them,
amazing,
how to formulate something in their life that would bring transformation so they'd look more like Jesus. So it wasn't just hearing a message and responding. Now how do we live this out? And so it says that they met in temples and homes. And so we want to encourage you, inspire you, that you would place the same kind of onus and priority on small groups, on dinner parties, as you do on Sunday. Treat it with the same level of excellence. And so once we saw that blueprint, we realized this needs to be our rhythm, needs to be our grace each week, so that it's not just about Sunday, but through the week people have relationships and friendships, that we break bread together, that the power of the table is where we'll see true freedom and transformation in people's lives.
Amen. And it really is as simple as opening a home and opening the Word of God, yeah, praying for people, smiling, a culture of welcome and love. I love, there's a scripture in Proverbs that says, better vegetables served with love, Georgie's paraphrase, better vegetables served with love than an ox served with hatred. And so it's not about the fanciness of the space, or we say the dinner party can be as big as the space that is available. Mm. It's about excellence, but it's not about perfection. It's about opening up your space so people can experience an atmosphere of love and grace and acceptance.
Exactly. And it's so amazing when people open up their home, mm-hmm, and have that experience, because here in New York City, people are very isolated. So you have like 9 million people, and I think the amount of people only intensifies the feeling of loneliness. Mm-hmm. And so we've discovered that the table is the place where friendship can happen.
Exactly.
And we say that it's not like a lifelong group, but you'll meet lifelong friends. Yeah. So the group's not forever, because the heart is for it to be multiplied so we can reach the city. And so it's not a clique that you have forever, but through it, you're gonna meet people and have relationships and friendships and get established in the house of God.
Yes.
And feel like you're not alone anymore, which is what we all want. The powerful thing is that relationship is not the means for a vision. The vision is actually relationship.
Yeah.
And so if we actually understand that small groups are not just a means to produce something else, they are the goal, that people would be in community. We serve a triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So the goal is that our communities would reflect the heart of God. And God did something amazing through Jesus. He made access and made a way for us to have a seat at the table.
Yes.
And that's what heaven is. It's a big feast where we have a seat at the table. And that's what we're now doing on earth, in our cities, in our suburbs, in our areas. We're making room and exampling that this is what heaven's going to be like. So there's always room at the table.
Amen. So now we're going to talk about some of our best practices of how we've seen dinner parties thrive here in New York City.
Yeah, so we've discovered that there are some ways that you can really make small group culture, or for us, dinner parties, super healthy. You don't want to create things that make it harder for leaders or harder for members to discover what it means to follow Jesus and get healthier in their walk with God. And so one of the things we discovered is the structure of the leadership and the teamwork of those leaders is super important.
Yeah.
Jesus sent his disciples out two by two. So Jesus understood that collaborative leadership and people helping each other is way better than just the solo person going out on their own trying to make it. And so I think setting up our small groups and our leaders for a win. And there's many reasons why that's important. For us, four leaders works really well. And we've actually really had dinner parties never not run because of the support system that they have as leaders. So someone might have a bad week, or they're sick, or they've got busy stuff, work trips, kids stuff, whatever the issues are. Therefore, they got three other people that they can lean on weeks where it's more difficult. But together, they can actually make that community grow and make sure that they have health in the group. And so those four leaders also should always be raising up another four. So we're ready for multiplication. As soon as that room is filled with people, we shouldn't stunt the growth. We should be ready to launch another group. So it's not just about the care of the people, but also identifying leaders in that. Now with the four, maybe you want to describe the different roles of the four, because yeah, I think that's important.
Exactly. So the benefit of having a leadership team with a dinner party, like Josh was saying, is that it can always run. That's a huge benefit. But also it's so gifting related. And so different people have different giftings, as we all know. We're all great at some things and other areas of growth in other areas of our life. And so, me too. And so you're going to have someone who feels really confident to lead a discussion and make sure that theologically and the Bible study aspect of the night is clear and awesome and encouraging and uplifting. And then the second person is the host of the apartment. So someone has the responsibility to go, hey, you can use my house or my apartment for this space. We can use it every Wednesday. And then there is the hospitality person. Now this leader is just the guru for making an atmosphere feel warm and inviting. And has a sense of cleanliness too. So this person is really aware that, hey, maybe it's not the best thing to have a pair of underpants on the ground as people walk into the apartment. And they're the person who thinks that way. The person who thinks about lighting the candles, making sure things smell nice, making sure the food is presented just not in a perfect way, but in a really nice, warm way. And so those person's eyes are on that stuff. And then the fourth leader is like a connective person, someone who's sending out invites, who's remembering to reply to people and invite people and is confident and warm and feels confident enough to reach out to people who have maybe signed up for a group or a dinner party and has that boldness to invite them and then that diligence to follow up on that list of leaders. So just with these combination of giftings, we've just found it's a really powerful thing with dinner party or group leadership. And they will mix, so you'll find someone else will do the discussion. Someone else will pick up, oh, that hospitality gifting. And so it ebbs and flows, but generally, we found identifying those four leaders is really successful.
Yeah, therefore there's no confusion about what they're meant to do or they're crossing over each other's areas, but they can work together as a collaborative team to produce the best environment for people to grow in their love for God. And that's really important, again, because the momentum of the individuals in your church is tied to your small group system.
Yeah. Wow.
And so therefore, if the small group system isn't working and it's canceling all the time and people can't find a place to meet and leaders aren't prepared and ready, really the discipleship of that individual in your church is stunted based on the health of the leader.
Yeah.
And so if the leaders are growing and they're healthy and helping each other out and they're really connected to Sundays and Wednesdays for us, then the members in that can actually grow. And for all of us, we want healthy people in church. We don't want just people that are attending. We want them growing in the word and prayer. Why? Because if they grow in word and prayer, they're going to love people in the city. And if they love people in the city, more people are seeing the glory of God. Their heart is awakened to the love of Jesus. Mm. And we start to see the essence of transformation in our cities. And so it's so important. Every detail matters, not because it's another thing for us to do or another church activity, but
right,
every detail matters because it is about the one. It is about that person. And so we do things also like, let's walk through the structure of the night.
Yeah.
We do things that we call threshold ministry. So on Sundays, you're gonna always have welcomers, or at least a church that wants to be welcoming has welcomers. You have people at the front with signs and different things that make people feel invited into church. The foyer is set, there's hospitality, there's lighting, there's banners, there's things that bring clarity to what this is and people feeling connected. If they're new, on their phone in the corner, there's a team that's connecting with them, making them feel comfortable. Yes. Mm-hmm. So that level of excellence on Sunday shouldn't stay there. It should transfer to Wednesday nights or whatever night you have small groups on. Why? Because that level of excellence is going to really help someone feel welcome and get planted in church. And so threshold ministry for us in New York City is that there's usually about three or four barriers, as we know. All the team are looking at me like, yes. You know, we have the street level, the door, then you have a hallway, then you have an elevator, then you have another hallway, then you have a door, then you have a security pad, you have a camera. Like, there's so many levels that you got to get through. Now, instead of seeing that as a negative, we've tried to make that a positive. So that at every threshold, we aim to have a welcomer, someone that's there, that's open and smiling, and therefore, instead of someone being confused where they're going, at every place they're being welcomed, and their heart, instead of being hard, is actually being softened before they even get into the actual gathering. So that by the time they get in, they're thinking, hopefully internally, if we've done a good job, man, I've never been welcomed into a space like this ever before. Even their friends probably don't do that at their apartment. So here's the church welcoming people in. And I think that's exactly what grace does. At every threshold, it says, hey, you may not be used to this, but you're welcome here. And so there's so many things that go on as we welcome people into that environment. And then once they're in, we say that the first hour is party, because 50% of dinner party is party. And so that's so important.
So important. And so a culture of welcome includes the threshold moments. People welcoming people in as they walk in the door of the apartment with just genuine smiles and joy, and to make them feel comfortable, because it can be daunting to walk into someone, a stranger's house. So we need to remember that as leaders. We can get so familiar as leaders in churches, in dinner parties, wherever our context is, but we need to remember what it was like to be that new person who walked in the door. And remember that not over the top like weirdness, but just a nice warm welcome. And you can feel yourself here, you can feel comfortable, just relax, it's gonna be a fun night. And so that first hour of just mingling, hanging out, eating is so important to create that atmosphere. And you know, all different types of people are going to walk into our apartments or our homes for dinner party if the church is growing in a great way, right? And so I remember when we first started the church, we had, literally the spectrum of New York City's people enter our apartment. So we had high-end business people turn up after work, like from Wall Street. We had homeless people turn up, and they're all in one room mingling together. And I'm reminded of Matthew chapter 9, where it says, Jesus dined with sinners and tax collectors. We need to be prepared when we're opening up our spaces to welcome the city, to welcome the neighborhood in. We can't have preference for a certain type of person or what someone looks like, or maybe they don't fit even what our church might look like at that stage. But God wants us to invite in the city, the neighborhood, the nation, into our houses. So whatever that looks like, we can feel confident and bold to invite them into our space. And with wisdom, I think that's so important. So I think we had one story one night early on. We had a friend of ours who at the time was living on the streets, and he was just new to faith, and we were just reaching out to him. And he came in, and it was great. We were so thrilled he came to dinner party, and we had a guest speaker that night. And turns out the guest speaker's iPhone was stolen that night from our apartment. So, but I mean, building the house of God, building the church, is not going to be clean and neat and perfect all the time. There is risk to it, and Jesus got his hands dirty. He got down on his knees and washed people's feet. And sometimes it looks like that for dinner party, where we are going to be serving and loving the city, and it feels almost unjust in a way. Like, oh, should that have cost me anything? That cell phone was stolen. But Jesus gave his all to serve the city. And I just always think of that story as a powerful reminder to us as group leaders or dinner party leaders to be willing to live that way and love that way.
And I brought him home, and I even said, hey, babe, we need to give him a shower and some clothes. Yeah. But we also had a baby that was being bathed in that same bath. And so just the comprehension of, wow, this is someone else's dirt,
right,
and junk in our space. Wow. But to be uncomfortable in order to see your church, your small group, wow, truly reach people.
Yeah.
It's not going to be easy some weeks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Some weeks are going to be like that, where things get stolen or things go missing. But what are we willing to risk in order for the sake of the gospel,
yeah,
wow, so people experience eternity? Mm-hmm. Yes. He received Christ. We led him in,
yeah,
a prayer. And that is the greatest thing. That's why we do what we do, is people meeting Jesus. So once people get through all the amazing welcomers that I'm sure you're gonna set up, it's really important that we set the atmosphere in our homes, in our apartments, mm-hmm, in our small groups. And traditionally, I've grown up in small groups, and sometimes we can just be a little bit casual when it comes to food.
Yes.
It can just be like chips and salsa on a table, or no one's really kind of welcoming or offering anything. But we really want our dinner parties, our small groups, to be a place where immediately they feel the service.
Yeah. Yeah.
That a drink is handed to them, great food is offered to them. They're not kind of sitting on the couch by themselves waiting for someone to talk to them.
Yeah.
But there's an environment of not just a welcome and a smile, but then we go beyond that. And we're willing to maybe have conversations that maybe we're not even interested in.
Right.
Or things we don't know about, but being very focused on listening to their name,
right,
and hearing what their job is, and not zoning out or being distracted, but giving your full attention. So all these details, whether you hand them a drink or hand them some food, all this really creates the atmosphere. And
absolutely,
in fact, we've discovered that some of the groups that grow the fastest are those that have the best food.
Funny that.
I know, but isn't it amazing how often sometimes in Christian small groups, the food can be just a little bit, I know not in your church, but in some places it can just be a little bit bland.
Totally.
And a little bit not well prepared.
Totally, and we might spend more time preparing food for other people like friends or family.
Right.
But this is welcoming in,
wow,
people from,
yeah,
our city that need to feel that welcoming love. So we believe just in the importance of food presented really well, great tasting food.
That helps.
In a dinner party. And you know, you don't actually need a whole lot of resource to do this well. If resources are tight, if the budget's a little tight, there are creative ways to feed people really well. And I just remember doing a lot of pasta. So pasta with red sauce was a win for us. I would jump on the train and go into the city, into Union Square, and grab all the pasta and grab the wine there because it was more affordable, and come back on the train and make my red sauce. And people loved it. There's something so warm and inviting about that.
Mm.
And it didn't cost a lot, but it was really filling for everyone. We didn't run out of food and it looked great.
You put a lot of love in that.
People
could taste the love.
Mama's love.
That's it. Yeah, and it's so powerful just what food does, because Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. And so there's something powerful when you break bread together, yeah, people open up more. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes we want to dive into like some intense conversations,
yeah,
but food and great hospitality, again, just makes all of us feel comfortable.
Yeah.
And there's nothing better than just having a full stomach. I think you can kind of focus more,
yeah,
and have, there's a bit more freedom and a sense of fulfillment.
Yeah.
But if people are hungry and they're grumpy, or I like to call it hangry,
which
yeah, I get a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really important, again, food is not just a physical thing, it is really spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes we make
good,
the spiritual things, what we would call spiritual things in the church world, oh, that's the really important stuff. But in
wow,
fact, much of the physical stuff, that's the real spiritual stuff.
Wow.
And so the level of care that we show in the cooking of the meals and the presentation, how we serve people, is really what connects people
mm,
to that dinner party or that connect group.
And I love the culture of, if people ask, can I bring something?
Yeah.
What a great opportunity for allowing them to contribute.
Yeah.
And there's something about turning up to a place with something in your hand, it's mm, a little easier to walk in the door.
Yeah.
And I think people love that feeling that they've contributed to the night.
And that's a great kingdom culture, because that's really important that isn't lost in society.
Uh-huh.
Like the idea of coming into a space and giving something.
Mm, beautiful.
So we talk about giving in church, but what are we giving into that connect group,
yeah,
or that dinner party? And at first, because we were starting the church, we said, oh, don't worry, we'll have everything provided. But we soon realized it actually helps them,
yes,
feel a part of it. So don't say no when someone wants to offer. that actually helps them feel connected and less awkward about the night.
It's true.
But once you get through some of the food and the eating, some of the party and fellowship, which is so important in developing friendship, is it is really important to talk about things that matter. People are there to have a night of transformation. Mm. That it's not often that people can have meaningful conversations. There's so much kind of, just things that don't really matter in everyday life,
right,
in terms of conversations around the water cooler, but this can be a conversation that truly changes their life.
Yeah. Mm.
But how we do that matters. It shouldn't be a regurgitation of Sunday's message. The idea is not just to have another preach, because Sunday tends to be a one-way conversation. Yes, there's welcoming and fellowship and you get to exhale and worship and recenter and focus on Jesus.
Right.
But the dinner party or the connect group is a place for a two-way conversation.
Yes.
So they're hearing a word on Sunday, but where are they unpacking it? Where are they understanding where this word can become incarnate? Well, that happens, I believe, in the small group, temple and home. That rhythm is super important. And so it's the leader's job, the discussion leader's job, not to preach another message at people, but rather welcome them into the freedom of his word.
Yeah, yeah.
We believe that happens through vulnerability. If they share something that has challenged them or impacted them in Sunday's message, for us, we kind of bounce off that. That's just a pivot point, like, hey, Pastor Georgie's message on faith last week, man, that really impacted me. I feel stretched in my faith. I feel like I've been too comfortable. I haven't been risking with my witnessing or loving people. When you share something that is a challenge and get specific about it, the whole room shifts.
Yeah.
Versus just sharing, hey, look at all my wins and look at my revelation. People tend to kind of back away. And you can share wins and victories, but make sure you share the journey and the trial and the test to get to that win. And as a result, people begin to open up. So really the idea for us in small groups is that people are sharing in the room and opening up. And no matter where they're at in that conversation, don't be shocked. Yeah. If there's something they share that you're like, whoa, that's an issue, we shouldn't have this kind of culture of condemnation.
Right.
Even though we may not say it, our faces can say it.
Right, like, it's true.
Whoa, that's a bit intense. Like, just really be mindful that people pick up on body language.
Yes.
And so all these things really affect the night.
They do. And we've had some crazy stories come up. And I think the response is just love and humility and understanding and warmth. And so you can show a sense of, wow, you went through that.
Yeah.
But there's a difference between like a shock and love and care.
Yeah.
And kind of allowing them to see how much you empathize and care for them. Mm-hmm. And I think it's so important that we have that culture of vulnerability and story. It makes it relatable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so important in a message when we're preaching to share stories, right?
Yeah.
But the same for our dinner party leaders, to share a story about some area of your life that has been impacted and that you've maybe struggled with this journey, but the Lord has helped you through.
Yeah.
We don't need to have arrived in order to share a testimony.
Right.
We don't need
That's
to be
so
perfect
good.
In order to share a story, because God's grace shines through it all.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah,
so wherever people are at, let them be at
yes.
that place, because the Bible says that truth shall set you free. But I've found unless we're truthful with where we're at, the truth can't meet us where we're at.
Yes.
Wow.
And so we have to acknowledge, here's where I'm at. And no matter where that is, let's let people be in that place, mm-hmm. but let's help them take the next step.
Yeah.
So once we share, open up, and again, not everyone will share and that's okay. Just let them feel comfortable. Eventually people will open up.
Great.
And then from there, we really believe in the power of prayer. Something really transpires. Don't go through a night without praying. Finish the night with that prayer, because the Holy Spirit is already there, but he's just waiting to whisper to someone or to say something in their heart. And prayer is that invitation.
Yeah.
So make sure you pray at the beginning in terms of the discussion. Just welcome a simple prayer. It doesn't need to be a long-winded thing. Just a simple prayer that makes people feel relaxed.
Right.
And then at the end of your small group, if it's a really big group, we recommend breaking off in smaller twos and threes so they can find their own prayer voice, make it relatable to what they talked about that night, and it kind of exercises their faith in that area, and then pray all together, and then continue to fellowship and hang out. Becomes a powerful, powerful night. Mm-hmm. And so we believe as people take off the mask and they have freedom in that small group setting, that Sundays are gonna mean so much more.
Yeah.
And make sure you connect it to Sunday. Don't leave them hanging. Give them the next step. Make sure it's prioritized about Sundays.
So we finished the group inviting to Sunday.
Yeah.
So never missing that moment to share what the theme for that week, what's going to be happening, just building the anticipation for Sunday.
Yeah.
So they've all heard it in one spot, and maybe they're discussing what service they're going to go to and should we sit together. Mm-hmm. And so people know when they turn up to church on Sunday that they're going to see people they know.
Yeah.
They're going to say, oh, I was in your apartment, or you were at that dinner party. Mm-hmm. And they're going to feel, within a bigger crowd of people, they're going to feel at home and like they fit and they can feel welcomed there.
So we hope that this dinner party discussion helps you. Again, whether it's small groups, house groups, connect groups, whatever you call your groups, let's get a heart for these, because in that, the journey and the growth of the individual is going to be so much stronger in our church. Jesus said that we should make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That word baptize means to be fully immersed.
Yeah.
Small groups help people to be fully immersed in the love between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So let's make room on our tables, let's make room in our homes, and let's do it with excellence and care so that people can grow.
So we're so excited for all God is going to do as we faithfully step out and plant dinner parties, groups, start them, open our homes. We know that God will do so much as we open up our spaces and our time and gather as a team to serve Him and serve our cities.